Yes, I'll try to be very quick because I realize that I stand before, I'm the only thing standing before you and having your dinner. So just where we left off, this conceptual framework of the fetal origins of adult disease, and you know, just to say that it was very quickly recognized that the placenta may play a very important role in the fetal origins of adult disease. And this is what I'm going to talk to you about, centered on the placenta, and then a little bit about genomic imprinting, which is something that you probably have not come across before, which links it nicely with the epigenetic regulation, given that imprinting is a paradigm example of epigenetic regulation. So the placenta is really a remarkable organ, and if I ask people in the street what do they think placenta is, most of them will say that it's a maternal organ, which is not true. If anything, a placenta is a fetal organ, so it originates from the fetus. But it's indeed a chimeric organ that in humans, as you know, lasts about 9 months, so it's a transient organ that lives outside of the fetus. It contains both maternal and fetal structures, so in rodents and in mice, there's about 30% that is maternal in origin and 70% that is of fetal origin. And there's a wide range of functions. And of course, everybody knows that it mediates the transfer of oxygen, CO2, water, ions, and nutrients, and also waste products. It produces and secretes a vast array of hormones, cytokines, and signaling molecules. It's of course also important for the immunological barrier from between the fetus and the mother. And so animal models actually have been quite useful to understand the basics of placentation. And what I have here is a human placenta, and this is actually a mouse placenta. And you can actually see that they look quite different from there to there. So morphologically, they look quite different, but it's the cell types that compose both are very well conserved, and also the molecular mechanisms. So we can use animal models to understand a lot about the molecular mechanisms of placentation and pregnancy disorders. And a little bit of placenta trivia, if you're into trivia and things like that. So the maternal blood, so focusing on the placenta, the maternal blood is free-flowing, so they are not within vessels. It's completely free-flowing, which also exists in the mouse. So there's a 150 ml reservoir of blood exchanges 3 to 4 times a minute. So it's an amazing free-flowing system. And 11 square meters of exchange surface at the time of birth, that's for the human placenta, of course, which makes it really almost efficient as a lung in gas exchange. So really remember that the placenta is literally the lungs and is literally the kidneys. And so it's of utmost importance. And it is obvious that it plays a central role in fetal programming, because any perturbation that occurs to the mother needs to be transmitted across the placenta, because this is the interface between the mother and the fetus. So it plays a central role in fetal programming because it directly regulates the fetal nutrient supply and therefore fetal growth. So I would like to just tell you a little bit about the mouse placenta, given that is the model that we work with. And the mouse placenta is mainly composed by 3 layers. So this is the maternal layer here of the sidra. Then you have a layer called the spongiotrophoblast layer, which does not exist. So it's this layer here, doesn't exist in humans. And we think that this layer, what it does, it produces hormones. So hormones that go into maternal circulation and they can affect the maternal physiology. And it's actually quite a good thing that it doesn't exist, that exists in the mouse, because we can genetically manipulate this layer and then ask the question, what are these hormones, what do they do in terms of maternal physiology? And then you have the labyrinthine layer, and this is the all-important layer where the exchanges between the mother and the fetus takes place. So what you have here is the maternal side here, and this is the fetal side. So the labyrinthine layer is composed of these cells here, which are called the sinusoidal trophoblast giant cells, which also have an endocrine function. And then you have these 2 layers of a syncytium. So a syncytium is just like the muscle, in the sense that there are multinucleated layers with no cytoplasm. So these are syncytium, two layers of those, and then you have the fetal capillaries. And so, of course, the nutrients need to go from them this side to the other side, and we'll see some of the main mechanisms by which this can occur. So that's three main mechanisms by which nutrients can go from the mother to the fetus, so towards this side. And of course, there's also circulation, not only from the mother to the fetus, because there's also the waste products they go into the mother. So this is going in bidirectionally in a way. So the nutrients can go by diffusion, transcellular diffusion, by what is called pericellular route. And so this means that there are some pores, pericellular pores, but it's quite interesting because when you talk to placental people, they said, oh, we've never seen a pericellular pore, but everybody talks about them. So I still don't understand how this works. So it goes through pericellular pores that nobody has actually seen, but there is evidence that they exist. And then they have proper channels, a very important mechanism. Things like amino acids and glucose, they can simply diffuse to the other side, but this is really at a very low rate. There are numbers, people say about 15% that can go through simply diffusion. And then you have the most important way of transporting things is by having transporters. So transporters that some of them don't require ATP, so they are calling a gradient. So if they are more here on this side, they will just literally follow the gradient towards the fetus using this transport mechanism. And others that go against the gradient, meaning they are more on the fetal side than on the maternal side, which means that they need to be transport against the expenditure of energy and ATP. And of course, there's exocytosis and endocytosis mechanisms. So in the mouse, we have very cool ways of actually measuring how many nutrients go from the mother to the fetus. And actually, some of these, this sort of methodology, which uses radiolabeled solutes, were many, many years ago actually done in humans, the time where those sort of experiments were allowed to inject radiolabeled solutes, or so I'm told. So what we do here, we literally inject these radiolabeled solutes into the jugular vein of a female that has the pups inside. And it's when we use genetic modified mice, half of them will be mutants and the other half will be wild type. So we can directly compare within the same maternal environment how much is being transferred. And these are the sorts of things that we measure: passive diffusion, facilitated and active transport. And I'm going to talk a little bit about this in more detail in a minute or so. And we can also, by doing a placental, what we call placentostriology, measure the surface area of the fetal capillaries, of the maternal blood spaces, and the thickness of the exchange barrier, so the syncytium that I'll talk to you about, that there's two layers of those. So we can have a pretty picture about what's happening in terms of placentation. And this is what I meant by talking you through the mechanisms and the variable levels that we use, and you'll see this described during the talk. So if we want to study passive diffusion, and passive diffusion, it's more on the maternal side and less on the fetus, so it goes across through the gradient, we use these INET molecules, inulin or mannitol, that have been labeled with 14C. Glucose, for instance, is one that can go through diffusion, but the majority of it, when you need a lot of glucose, you need transporters. So there are glucose transporters. But they go also according to the gradient. So normally you have more on the maternal side than on the fetal side, but you have to have transport for this to make it quicker. And then you have amino acids. And we use this particular amino acid analog, which is none of this is metabolizable. And we use this as a paradigm of a particular sort of amino acids called system A amino acids, which I'm going to refer at the very end of the talk. And here is the opposite. There's more on the fetal side than on the maternal side. So you need to transport this using ATP. So what the other thing that I would like to say is that there are wonderful morphological adaptations that occur during pregnancy. One of them is that this barrier here gets thinner and thinner and thinner when you go along the gestation. And this is because the fetus actually When it grows maximally in terms of fetal growth is at the very late gestation, where they, it really accrues mass and the growth is at its maximum in terms of absolute terms. And so this gets thinner, and therefore more will go through diffusion. And the other important thing to say is that there is an expansion of the fetal capillary, so the surface area for transport increases dramatically also in late gestation to accumulate the fetal demands for growth. So what we're really doing in the lab is using genetic models to manipulate what we call the nutrient resource allocation. So this is a genetic manipulation of the resource of the maternal nutrients. And it's a very simple idea, is by using genetically engineered mice, we'll make mice that have a small placenta or a very big placenta, but the fetal size stays the same, stays normal, at least initially. Okay? And then we do the reverse. So normal size placenta, and we make very big mice and very small fetuses, and then ask the question, what happens to the placenta? So this system here addresses the placental supply, and this here assesses the fetal demand for nutrients, because how much you grow or less you grow will create a different level of demand for nutrients, because there's also everything to do with cell proliferation and how much food you need to grow. And so these are the things that we really are aiming with this kind of research program. And I'm going to talk to you about some of these placental adaptations when we do these models. So really to ask the question if the placenta is a dynamic organ or if it's just a passive recipient of nutrients that it gets from the mother. And we'll see that's quite a remarkably dynamic process that's going on. Now, on the other hand, we're trying to find out what are the signals that go from the fetus to the placenta to control the placental function. And I'll give you some examples that link specifically the placenta to programming and to the fetal origins of disease. We have very little evidence. Before this work, we didn't have any evidence, direct evidence that the placenta works directly to cause long-term programming of health. And I'm going to show you a very, very interesting study we've done in collaboration that shows precisely that. But first, I would like to go through genomic imprinting, because the way we do these models is by manipulating the expression of imprinted genes. And I believe that many or very few of you know what an imprinted gene is, right? Anyone imprinted genes? Okay, so imprinted genes are the most beautiful genes you can have in your genome because of this. Of course, I'm biased. But so we all receive the gene from the father and one copy from the mother. So the very majority of genes are going to be expressed from both, at some stage in development, from both the paternal and the maternal allele, correct? But now look at what happens to imprinted genes. They are expressed preferentially from one allele in a parent of origin-dependent manner. So what does this mean? That there are very few genes, we know about 140 so far, that are going to be either expressed exclusively from the paternal allele or from the maternal allele. So there's an equal number of paternally expressed genes to maternally expressed genes. So this is really expression of genes according to the parental of origin. It is important which parent you received it from, because it's only going to be active from that parent. And so if it is, so we call this situation here is biallelic expression, expressed from both alleles, the vast majority of genes in the genome. This one is monoallelic expression according to parental of origin, in this case, maternally expressed gene, in those cases, paternally expressed genes. Of course, the silencing of the other allele, so this is maternally expressed, so it means that the paternal copy is going to be silenced and is silenced by DNA methylation and histone modification. So you have DNA methylation as a silencing mechanism, and you have the repressive histone modifications associated with this. So if you look at imprinted genes and you look at their epigenetic pattern, you'll see that one allele is completely different from the other. And that's completely different from the other genes that are expressed from both copies. And this has nothing to do with the sex chromosomes, because this happens in a variety of chromosomes that are not linked with the X or the Y. And so this creates a little bit of a problem for people to understand imprinting. So there are 140 genes that are really key for mammalian development. If you have a disruption of imprinting, you'll die in utero very, very early. So there are key genes for mammalian development. The regulation will cause disease. I'll give you a nice example of a disease that is caused by imprinting dysregulation. And they have really a very special role in placental biology, and that's why we follow these genes. So the question is, this is an epigenetic mechanism, and it's a remarkable one. So how does it actually work? So the beauty about the system is this. A somatic cell in the body knows exactly which chromosome came from the mother and which chromosome came from the father. And then it does something about it, which is the monoallelic expression. So how does this work? So you don't need to be a rocket scientist to know that the key of imprinting is a differential epigenetic marking that exists at the levels of the gametes. So in other words, so this is DNA methylation. In other words, the oocyte for this particular region comes methylated, and the same region in the sperm is unmethylated. So this is a way of differentiating the two. A clearly epigenetic mark that is different between the two gametes. So when these come together, so the sperm fertilizes the egg, you need to maintain the imprint. And so we call this part of the life cycle of the imprint. So there's an imprint maintenance. And this is not easy because, as I told you in the last talk, there is a genome-wide wiping up of or erasure of these marks at the global level in the entire genome. And the imprinted genes are the only or one of the very few sequences of very few genes that escape this genome-wide demethylation event. So they need to be maintained. And then what happens is that in the fetus and the placenta or all tissues, these imprints are going to be read. So this will know that this imprint is marking the maternal allele and then is expressed. And the other one is not methylated, but there's another system which makes it going to be repressed. So this is really what happens at the level of the somatic cells. But what is very important, and this is part of the beauty of the imprint, is that the imprints need to be erased and they're going to be established in the germ cells. So during the embryonic development, you have the germ cells being developed and you can either add a female gonad or a male gonad. But the imprints, and this is quite important, the parental imprints need to be erased. They're going to be erased and new imprints are going to be established according if it is a female or it is a male, and then it restarts the life cycle. So it's crucial that you erase the imprints according to the sex of that germline. Otherwise, you'll mix the imprint completely from one to the other generation. And so this is where these imprinted genes are very important for. It regulates the key aspects of mammalian physiology. This includes imprinted genes that actually act in mom to control maternal resource allocation. Very important, a number of imprinted genes that work in the placenta, placental development and function. And the other key area in addition to the placenta is the brain, so the embryonic and postnatal brain, so to control behavior and development. And we have a number of genes that we know are very important. But this is not only, so you can see that also imprinted genes represented here are important for adipogenesis and regulation of energy homeostasis. So it's a very cool set of genes with many different functions. And it's still amazing why, and we can discuss this later, why do we have this very awkward way of regulating genes that is according to the parental of origin. So I'm just going to, we work a lot on IGF-2, and IGF-2 is a growth, very important growth factor. And I'm just going to explain you briefly how imprinting of IGF-2 occurs. So IGF-2 is a paternally expressed gene. What does this mean? That it's expressed only when it comes from the father. The maternal allele is going to be switched off. But notice that just 90 kb downstream, there is this gene, which is a non-coding RNA called H19. And age 19, interestingly, has the reciprocal imprint. This time, it's a maternally expressed gene, a maternally expressed non-coding RNA. So this time is the maternal copy that is going to be expressed and silence the paternal one. So how does this work? It works because these two genes, they share a common set of enhancers which are located downstream of H19. So the reason why IGF-2 is maternally silenced is that upstream of H19, there is this region here to which, when unmethylated, there is a binding protein called CTCF, and what this is an insulator. So insulator means insulates enhancers from promoters. So the enhancers cannot go through this barrier, this insulator, and interact with IGF-2. So that's why IGF-2 is silent. But now, just see what happens on the paternal allele. Methylation here prevents the binding of the CTCF. It prevents the binding of the CTCF. It means that these enhancers now are free to go to IGF-2 and activate IGF-2. H19 is going to be silenced here because this methylation spreads over the body of this gene. So this is a beautiful example of how you can get regulation of imprinted gene due to methylation at this level of this differentially methylated region here. This is methylated in sperm. This is unmethylated in the oocyte. That is the parental mark that tells the cell which one is which. Does this have any relevance for humans? Yes, because, so remember, this is the normal pattern, which is amplified here. So paternal IGF-2 here, maternally silent. CTCF binds, so you can't have the arrow there. But there are some few cases where you get methylation on this allele. So if you get methylation on the maternal allele, CTCF cannot bind, and you get the enhancers interacting with the maternal, normally silenced maternal IGF-2. If you get it from both copies, it is a growth factor. What you get? You get a syndrome called the Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. These kids are about, so normal kid will be born 3.5. These kids are born about 5 to 6 kilos. And they obviously creates a problem. They have very large tongue normally, and they have a very high predisposition to tumors. But nonetheless, postnatally, these kids, they actually catch down. But you can also have the reverse, which is, in this particular case, you lose the methylation on this allele, and if you lose the methylation, it means that CTCF can now bind here and is less access of IGF-2 to the promoters of IGF-2, and therefore less enhancer means less IGF-2, and the outcome is the reverse, is a baby that suffers from Silver-Russell syndrome. There's quite a few of those which causes is caused by IGF-2 levels going down. So this is a good example of epigenetics in action through imprinting. So what does the IGF-2 system does? So I've talked to you a little bit about the H19 ICR that controls the imprinting of the IGF-2 gene. So this is a growth factor. Bioavailability of IGF-2 is controlled by, to a certain extent, by binding proteins. So this is something that acts like a normal, in a way, so you can find it in circulation and IGF. So there's binding proteins that bind to IGF-2. And mainly IGF-2 actions are going to be done through the IGF type 1 receptor, all the signaling, the proliferation, and metabolic responses mediated by IGF-2. They are mainly done by this type 1 receptor, although it does have some affinity for the insulin receptor. And excess of IGF-2 is going to be cleared by an IGF-2 receptor. So the function of this is to bind IGF-2 and send it to lysosomes for degradation. So we've been working a lot on the mouse IGF-2 gene, and you can see, so this is an RNA in situ hybridization. So very highly abundant, very strong in the tongue, very little in the brain apart from this structure here called the choroid plexus. And so this really gives you the transcripts, the mRNA level, fetus and the placenta. And there are differences between the mouse and the rat, which are very high in the fetus and very little in adult. But if you see in human, there's quite a lot of human of IGF-2 still present in serum, in the blood in humans. So there's quite a big difference between that system and the rodent. Nonetheless, we've learned quite a lot about how this works. So what did we do was, we're asking the question, as I said to you at the beginning, we want to manipulate the size of the placenta independently of the fetus. So we found a way of reducing IGF-2 levels here, but not here. So all the fetal IGF-2 is normal, produces IGF-2 into circulation. The only thing that they have is a problem in the placenta. And we've done that by identifying a particular transcript of IGF-2. So there's only one protein of IGF-2, but different promoters and different transcripts. And this is what we call the placental-specific IGF-2 transcript, only found in that very important layer, which is the labyrinthine, where the maternal or where the exchanges of the maternal to the fetus takes place. And it's indicated here. We've knocked that out. And as a result, you get a very small mouse. So remember, the only thing we did manipulate here was the levels of IGF-2 in this exchange barrier, nothing more. And you get a very small mouse, about 30% smaller, because you do get a very small placenta. So we're basically taking out IGF-2 from there makes a very miniature placenta. But it's one of the very few models where you can manipulate, where you can address the questions to the placenta, because it's specifically to the placenta, the manipulation that we've done. And so what you see here, which was really interesting to us, is that you see the placental weight. So this is the wild type curve. This is the P0. You can see that the placenta becomes growth restricted very early on at day 14, but the fetus only becomes growth restricted very, very late on. So why is a placenta that is very small earlier on only has an impact on the fetus at such a late stage? And the answer is because there is a compensation. So this is the experiment. We've made, this is the normal, the wild type. We've made a placenta that is small because it lacks IGF-2. But the fetus is normal for IGF-2. This placenta is small through the beginning, but is sensing, the fetus is sensing that the placenta is small and is sending signals to the placenta to upregulate amino acids and glucose. And this is the remarkable adaptation of the placenta, which seems to be responding to the fetal demand signals, because, of course, it's a small placenta. The fetus at some stage is still normal, growing, asking for more food to the small placenta, and the small placenta has this reaction of, this is how I think it works, of upregulating transport across. And it transports more amino acids and more glucose. Unfortunately for the system, late in gestation, this system of compensation fails. You can't upregulate in particular. You can upregulate glucose, but you can't upregulate amino acids, and the fetus becomes growth-restricted. The key question is, what would happen if you didn't have this adaptation? You probably would not survive. The fetus wouldn't be survived. And how do we know that there is a fetal demand signal? Because we now knocked out IGF-2 in the placenta, but also in the fetus. So now there is a match between the size of the fetus and the size of the placenta. They're both small, so there is no need for more food because they are matched for size, the fetus and the placenta. So in this IGF-2, there's no IGF-2 expression in the fetus or in the placenta, no circulating IGF-2, and because there is no fetal demand signal for growth, there is no adaptive response. So this is the first direct demonstration that the growth of the fetus can manipulate the size and the function of the placenta. And so we call those a fetal demand signal. And so the cool experiment we did, I told you I was going to show you data that shows that the placenta has an important role in programming of adult health, is the following. So this is what IGF-2 does, is an important regulator of the supply and demand for maternal nutrients, makes the fetus grow, that means more demand for nutrients, and on the placental side, makes the placenta grow and supply more nutrients. And so you can do these imbalances by knocking out IGF-2 in the different situation. But what my colleagues at Cardiff were interested in is this, that the fetal growth restriction is known to be linked with a range of psychiatric effects and emotional disorders. So what they wanted to do is to ask the question, what about if we use this IGF-2 P0 P0 knockout, which has a defect only in the placenta and placenta only, and then address the question compared to the IGF-2 total knockout and wild types, do they have different modulation of emotional behavior? So the study is the following. It was just published a few weeks ago. So you do what you do. You compare, you do behavioral studies in mice between the IGF-2 P0, the one that has an imbalance of the supply and demand. Remember, this is the one that you have the fetus placental modified. You compare it with the IGF-2 total knockout that has supply and demand balanced because they are both small. And then you do the wild type, which has a normal demand and supply system. Important, and this is why we use imprinted genes, is because the mothers are completely wild type. So many of these genetic studies, you have the confound that you're also playing, you're also modifying the maternal genotype, but not in imprinted genes, because remember, IGF-2 is silent from the maternal allele, so the mothers can receive their allele, a mutated allele, and still be of normal size because the maternal allele is silenced. So that's quite important. And they did a series of behavioral testing, as I told you, in mice. And so this, I'm representing here this particular one, which is called novelty place preference. So what you do, you put a mouse in a box, and there is an habituated site, so this is where they spend most of their time. And then suddenly you open this little door that goes into a novel site. And normally a wild type mouse will go and start going and exploring this novel site very reluctantly with fear. This is 30 seconds, 60 seconds, it goes a little bit more. 120 by 240 is relatively comfortable about it. But now look at what happens to the peanuts. The peanuts never get, at least initially, the same reaction at all. So they spend much less time in the novel site. This means that these mice are more fearful. And so this is quite consistent across the board. It's for this, for another behavioral tests. So in conclusion, the peanut knockout shows a consistent increase in anxiety-related behaviors. But the shocking thing is that this is not seen in the IGF-2 total knockout. And why is this important? We shall see that why this is important in a minute or so. This is another example of a behavioral test called the elevated plus maze. And you have an open arm here, and it's the same issue that the wild types do very well in this testing that the peanuts never do. And you can clearly see here what happens. So, conclusion is that interfering with imprinting IGF-2 during gestation leads to long-term effects on behavior. But this can't be explained by the IUGR, the intrinsic growth restriction, because remember, both IGF-2 total knockout and the P0, they are both small. So this is nothing to do with the fact that it's small and that you have this behavioral effect. So it's something that is ascribed to the placenta. And so it's really this mismatch, the balance between the demand from the fetus, from nutrients, and this capability of the placenta to meet those demands that seem to be critical. So it's really how the placenta is functioning that are programming this behavior later on in life. And we don't know really about the mechanisms. Michael has started doing some studies on gene expression, and he can see some GABAergic and serotoninergic neurotransmitter genes that are clearly modified in the PNET, in the P0, IGF-2, P0, but not in the IGF-2 total null. And so we're starting to learn how all this actually happens. And so in the next 10 minutes or so, we're just changing the experimental model. So I showed you things about what happens if you have a small placenta, so how this affects the fetal growth and what is the response of the fetus to controlling the placental adaptive responses and the mechanisms, or at least what consequences does it have for long-term programming. So now we go to the opposite, which is making this model here. So this is the same model as the Beckwith-Wiedemann. Remember I told you that you could make, in humans, you make these big mice by having biallelic expression of IGF-2. In the mice, you can recapitulate that overgrowth. So if you take out the H19 and the imprinting control region, the enhancers can now freely act on the maternal allele, and you get this biallelic expression of RGF2. You have more RGF2, and you have this massive placenta compared to the wild type. So this is what intrigued us, and this again tells us a lot about the beauty of placenta as a dynamic organ, is that, so if you can see here, the placenta is disproportionate relative to the fetus. So you have 130% and the fetus is only 112% bigger, 145 and 123. So in other words, this placenta is much bigger than the fetus and overgrown than the fetus. And the question was, why isn't it matched? Why does not the fetus grow to match the size of the placenta? So in other words, why aren't they more overgrown, the fetuses? We looked at these placentas, and they're absolutely normal. They are just bigger. So they should be able to be transporting a lot more of nutrients and attain a bigger fetal size. And we were quite gobsmacked when we actually did the placental transfer assays, the in vivo ones. We can measure the amount of nutrients that are being transferred from the mother to the fetus. And every single mechanism of transplacental flux was reduced. So this is diffusion markers, this is glucose, and this is MIB. So in other words, the overgrown placenta is actually per gram of placenta down-regulating the nutrient transport, which is again something that probably has to do with the fetal demand for nutrients that comes from the fetus itself. And we think that this is indicative of a mechanism that limits the total demand. So it's not in the interest of the mother to have all of her resources going through the placenta. And so this is some of the molecular factors that we have identified, some of the nutrient transporters. This is glucose transporter 3, and this is an amino acid transporter of the system A, identified this way. But this doesn't really end here, this story about overgrown of the placenta and of the fetus, because if you have a placenta that is so big, you may ask the question that this might have an impact on maternal physiology, because see, you have more of the spondylotrophoblast layer, presumably producing more hormones into the maternal circulation. And so what we've really nicely shown in this particular model is that if you have a litter where you have a pup that is overgrown together with a normal-sized one versus compared to a litter that only has control normal-sized ones, you have a big difference in glucose tolerance here. So in other words, if in a litter you have mice that are overgrown placentas, overgrown fetuses, they alter the maternal, the glucose concentrations in mom. And so this is an evidence that the fetal placental RGF2, we think it's all down to the placenta, can actually make this difference in terms of eventually risk of gestational diabetes. So you alter the maternal concentrations of glucose just by having the fetus or the placenta bigger within a litter. And so this is quite an interesting finding from the aspect of the biology of overgrowth. And so lastly, we're asking the question about these placental adaptations in another setting, a setting where we actually feed mice. And this work was done by Amanda Sferuzzi-Perry in the Center of Trophoblast Research. So what happens to what are the fetal placental consequences if you have a maternal high sugar, high fat diet during pregnancy? And so this very simple experiment, you just give a mother an obesogenic, what we call obesogenic maternal diet, full of sugar and fat. And this is done only during pregnancy. And then we compare this with the standard maternal diet, and then we assess the fetuses at day 16 and day 19, which is mid to late gestation, for a number of parameters. And so asking the question, what happens to these placentas? And so the conclusion in a nutshell is that it does impair the placental growth and fetal growth trajectory. So that's the conclusion of the study. So if she's shown definitely that the high sugar, high fat diet induced an excess of maternal fat deposition as measured by DEXA. And you can see that's increased here at E16 and increased here at day 19. But strangely enough, you would expect this would be associated with fetal overgrowth, but it isn't. So you can see that at day 16, it's actually the fetus are smaller, but there is an intrauterine catch-up growth in the sense that later on in gestation, the fetus now normalizes completely the growth of the fetus. So you don't, at birth, you don't see any difference. But the placenta is always smaller throughout. So you have a smaller placenta that leads to a fetal weight decrease at day 16, which is then normalized to the 19. And this is very similar to what happens to the IGF-2P0, in the sense that there must be some mechanisms that are compensating for a small placenta to provide enough nutrients to the fetus. And that's exactly what we've shown, is that this high-fat and high-sugar placentas, they actually upregulate, similarly to the P0, quite a bit of the amino acids and the glucose at day 16, which presumably contributes to the normalization of the fetal growth. And this is associated with particular amino acid transporters that we see upregulated at E16 but not E19. And a particular class of genes that always seem to be affected in these models is the system A amino acid transporters. And so these system A amino acid transporters, just to give you a brief background, this is literally the last two slides. So this system A, they code for amino acid transporters. There are three in the genome, and they're all clustered together. And what they do, they specifically transport small neutral amino acids. Some of them are indicated here, alanine, serine, the only, and these are non-essential amino acids. The only amino acid that is transported essential is methionine. And what is beautiful about these amino acid transporters is that they promote the uptake of amino acids into the cells, but they don't do the efflux. They don't take them out from the cells. So the other amino acid transporters or the other transporter systems, they can actually feed off of the concentration of amino acids provided by this. And to our amazement, one of the family members is actually an imprinted gene, which is a paternally expressed. They are all very abundant in the placenta, and we've decided to knock them out in the mouse as a proof of principle that our supply and demand systems can identify new key genes involved in fetal growth. If you take out the imprinted one, you can see a very striking effect on placental weight compared to the wild type, and then eventually the fetus are going to be growth-restricted, and they are growth-restricted since earlier on. Strangely enough, this doesn't mean to be mediated through the mTOR, which is the nutrient and amino acid sensing system in the body. And we also have taken out the other two family members by performing chromosome engineering that takes the two genes in one go, and there's a clearly growth restriction and a penetrance of neural tube defects that affects about 20% of the homozygous ones. And because these are amino acid transporters, look at what happens to the amino acid composition in the fetal plasma. So they have important roles in doing the transplacental flux, because many of these amino acids, not only the system A substrates, but also the essential amino acids, are very, very reduced in the fetal plasma of these animals. So we suspect this is all down to, if you take out these from the placenta, you don't get the amino acids across. And so the last slide, I hope that I've shown you that the placenta is quite a dynamic system. It acts, we like to call it a nutrient sensor, and it will adapt its phenotype to optimize the growth of the fetus in terms of the survival of the fetus. So there's a various number of allocation signals. The growth-restricted placenta, IGF-2P0, upregulates the transfer in response to fetal demand signals. So this, not only at the level of the genetic manipulation I've showed you for the IGF-2, but also nutritional ones like the high-fat and high-sugar diet. And that the system A amino acid transporter seems to be a recurrent theme in all of these supply systems. It's a key player in this adaptive response, and we've shown by the knockouts that is essential for fetal growth, and these are unpublished data that I've just shown you. Also, the interesting bit that an overgrown placenta actually reduces the transfer efficiency to make sure there is a limit to the amount of nutrients that can be extracted for the mother, and so this is our interpretation. Funnily enough, this is associated with maternal glucose concentrations during pregnancy that can be affected if you mess around with the fetal and placental IGF-2 and therefore growth. And lastly, there are these adaptive changes in the placenta that we think are at the basis of these long-term problems that I've shown you. Not only maternal metabolism, we've shown for the brain function, and we're now trying to understand if there is any impact on type 2 diabetes or obesity in these diverse models. And the last most important slide, the people that have actually done the work, and you'll see that they're all smiling quite a lot because they're EpiLab. And most of the work with the IGF-2 manipulations were done by Yunel. Katharina is no longer with us. She's now working in another lab in Switzerland. Emily has now left the lab as well. And these three people, they did most of the genetic manipulations. Amanda did the IFAT sugar together with Abby Wilkinson and AmbiLabs for the behavioral studies, and of course the importance of the fundus. Thank you very much for your attention. Be pleased to answer any questions. I believe there won't be any, so all the very best.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. There is one question here.